This is Helen Lewis, take 9. You were describing how the SS man confronted you with a gun and said...
Threw me out.
Threw you out.
Yes. So I stumbled out, and within 2 yards or so, I saw a shed, a wooden shed of decrepit, and I crept in somehow, and inside there was a goat. And I realized it was the first live animal, except the awful dogs of the SS, that I had seen. And I stroked it, and I sat down beside it, and I fell asleep beside the goat. And suddenly, I said, in the morning, I heard the goat, and the woman looked in. I could see that she was not exactly a very friendly thing. She was the owner of the goat and of the shed. And she said, "All right, come in." And she took me into her house. And it was a sort of little farmhouse. And she put me on the seat beside the fire. And I thought I was all right, I was safe. But it turned out, no, she was a very nasty creature. She had a young son who was not quite, he was a little bit weak in his mind. But she herself made it quite clear that if the German, you could hear shooting all the time, they were fighting for the village, the Russians and the Germans. And she made it clear. She said, if the Germans win, I hand you over right away. If the Russians win, I keep you here to show that I have saved you. And the fighting went on and on and on. You didn't know who was winning. He was just shooting and shooting, you know. And the boy came running in and out, and he would say, "The Germans are winning." Next one, "The Russians." You didn't know what was. It went on for hours. And then it was quiet, and it was over. And you didn't know what happened. And suddenly one heard outside, you know, boots. And the door opened. And in the door stood a very young, small, Russian soldier, and he said, "Germani kaput, we are here now, it's ours." And that was my liberator. And he had said, "Germani kaput." And so that was, so I, she allowed me to stay, but she didn't, she wasn't, she didn't. I was very, very ill with dysentery and God knows what. And some Russian officers came in and ordered her, there was one big room, that she had to clear it out, and because they would use it, officers, for their transient stays, they wouldn't stay. So one or two, you know, stayed there. One of them ordered her to bring me a full sort of vessel with hot water so that I could have a good wash, you know, things like that. And then, I think it must have been the third day, I felt absolutely awful. A very good-looking, very wonderful-looking Russian officer appeared. And he asked a quick, short question, who I was and what I was doing there, and I told him. And he nodded, and he went into that room. And after about half an hour or so, his, what do you call it, his you know, his help, his
Russian. His Batman.
Batman came out, and he said, "The major wants you to come in." And when I came in, I almost fainted. There was a table set with a white tablecloth, and across it there was a Russian flag, and the table was set for two people, knives and forks and glasses and spoons. As like in a completely normal home. And he stood there in full uniform. And when I walked in, he bowed. And he said, he had asked my name first, Lena. And asked my name, and said, "Welcome, Lena. I would like you to have a meal with me and celebrate with me the victory of the Red Army." And I went to the table, and he poured out some wine. He lifted a glass and said, "Before we sit down to our meal, we will drink to the victory of the glorious Red Army, to the liberation of your own country, and to the safe return of its president, Dr. Benesch." So he was a highly educated man who knew about it. I almost fainted, as you can imagine. we sat down, and I forced, I couldn't eat that sort of thing. How could I? And it was also quite spicy, you know. I forced myself not to nibble as much as I could, and we made conversation, and he told me he was a major, and he came from Irkutsk, I remember that, and what we were doing, and, you know, and he asked me, and I told him what I spoke Czech and he spoke Russian, and he tried to put it together, you know, as best as we could, you know, conversation. And then it was over the meal, and he thanked me for my company. It was in the ladies' company, and he went out on duty again. And I collapsed on the bank beside the fire, you know, I was so exhausted. And when he came back, there was, in that room, in that kitchen, was one bed, and he ordered her to she was sleeping in that, to move somewhere else and to give the bed over to me, said I needed a bed to sleep in. And I was, you know, that excitement and that thing hadn't helped very much, and was lying on the bed, and he was sitting there, you know, and I was very, very feverish, and also I had these awful spasms, you know, and whenever he lifted me up, he carried me out to an outdoor loo, waited there for me, and when I knocked at the door, he carried me back to the bed again. And yes, and that happened, oh, I don't know, 3-4 times during the night. And then in the early hours of the morning, he started talking to me when I was a little bit brighter. And he said it was from Irkutsk, and they were marching on to Berlin. His company, his part of, was marching on to Berlin. And then he said he was very, very worried about me, very, very sorry, because he had to leave me. And he didn't trust that woman, and what would happen to me. And he wants me to get home and to be safe. And he tore out a bit of pink paper from some notebook, and he wrote into it something, you know. And he gave me that, and he said, never let that go. And whenever you meet anybody rational, show it to them, and never let it go. And then he called that boy, the son of, and he told him, whenever it is possible, take her out from here, somewhere where there is a doctor, where there's medical help. And then kissed me on the forehead, saluted, stood there in full uniform, saluted and marched out. And that was my angel guardian, Kostya, my angel guardian. Without him and his message, I would never have got home. I showed it on many, many occasions, and everybody, it did its job.
Do you know what was actually written on that paper?
Yes,
you
know yes, yes. It said that it gave his name and rank, major, and his name, and it said that my name was Jena, not anything, and said he asks everybody, every Russian comrade or anyone, to help me to reach safely and in good my homeland. And thanking me for that.
Where had all this taken place? Where were you?
Was somewhere up there in what you would call Pomerania, in East Prussia.
Prussia
was there, and I, well, of course, I, yes, and the boy helped me back into the farmhouse where the SS men had chased me from. And they were absolutely delighted to see me alive, and they kept me there. And but it was obvious that I needed medical help. And on one day when it was, yes, that was an interesting day, a Russian officer or something walked in one day. And when he saw me lying there, well, I looked half dead, but still, a woman, when he saw me lying there, he became very interested, and they became very worried, you know, worried. And he came to my bed and looked down at me, and I held out a bit of paper to him, and he read it and walked out. So eventually the farmer took me out onto the road, and again a Russian lorry with some things passed, and he stopped it. And he showed him the bed, and he loaded me onto the lorry, and he took me, and about 2 hours' ride, to a town called Lauenburg, where there was a Russian lazaret, a hospital. This is where I ended up. This is where I stayed then for quite a long time until I was reasonably fit enough to go home.
Home being? Home being where?
Prague.
Yes.
Yes. Eventually, whenever I was, you know. And only there, of course, as in I found out that Paul was dead, you know. I didn't know that. Well, you know.
What had happened to Paul? What did you find out?
I found out in a, such a strange way. There was a central office there for information in Prague, and I went there as often as I could, as my strength allowed. And one day I stood, and she didn't know about it. One day I stood outside, and suddenly somebody called at me. It was a young fellow whom I knew vaguely from Theresienstadt. And he said, "Oh, I'm so glad to see you." In those days, one was so surprised to see anybody alive. And he came and he said to me, "You know, I was with Paul to the last moment." I said, "Oh, no, tell me about it." "Oh," he said, he was perfectly all right. He seemed to be perfectly all right. And the next morning he was gone. And I said, "Really? Gone where to?" And he looked at me and he said, "He was dead." And then he realized that I didn't know. And he became panicky. And he said, "Oh, there's my tram. I must go. Sorry." And he left me and he jumped. And this is how I found out. He died from his hunger and exhaustion. Well,
where?
In Schwarzheide, which was a camp belonging to Sachsenhausen or Oranienburg in Germany, not far from Berlin.
How did you get to be in Belfast in Northern Ireland from Prague?
Well, I had to go. I was in a very poor state, and I had to go and live with an aunt and uncle of mine who had survived happy because they had been a mixed marriage. He was, you know, in Mladaboleslav, a tall town, about 2 hours from Prague. And there it turned out I was so miserable, I had to go into hospital. And it was eventually a doctor who himself had been in a camp who treated me, and he was the only one what to do. And I was very slowly recovering and getting better. And then the day arrived, you know, I was told I would be released. And my aunt came to visit me on that day to help me pack. And she had a twinkle in her, and she said, "I have something for you." And she waved a letter into my face. And it came from a place that I only vaguely ever heard of, called Belfast. And it was from Harry. And Harry had seen my name on a Red Cross list of survivors. And he had written to me, and it took quite a long time before the letter eventually reached me. And he wrote to me that he was so glad to see that I had survived. "Please answer me, tell me what you need and what you want and what I can do." And what he didn't know Paul was dead. You know, that was purely a humane, you know, things, gesture of friendship. So I wrote back, and he wrote, and I wrote, and we corresponded. And in June 47, he came to Prague and we got married.
And
then it returned to him with a vengeance. He had parted because of my dance. And in Belfast, it all revived again. And Harry loved every moment of it.
And so you made your life in Belfast with Harry?
We got married in June 1947. Now I came to Belfast at the end of October. And, well, first I had to learn to get used to being there. It was very difficult, you know, very strange life, not at all what I had been used to. Language, climate, everything, attitude of people, customs. people had no idea what had gone on in Europe during the war. And there were sort of two different groups. When, if you started saying anything, one group would say, that's behind us, it's in the past. We have to put it aside and forget about it. Let's leave it alone. And the other group would say, oh, please, don't talk. It's so awful. I can't bear it. I will faint if I hear more. I wouldn't be able to sleep all night. Whereupon I said, cruelly, so what? What's a sleepless night? So this was it. And the Jewish community was not very forthcoming and helpful either. There was a very Orthodox rabbi there in those days who had probably considered that it wasn't, it wasn't decent to have survived. Yeah, they were very, very, very unwelcome.
And then did children come along?
And then Michael was born in 49 and Robin in 54. Yes, and she came along. And then in 55, by sheer chance, my dance career started up again. I think, did I not tell you, because there was a local school which was very, very well known for its music. And they were doing an opera called The Battered Bride by Smetana. I told you the story, did I not? Well, and the conductor of the orchestra said one day to somebody who, you know, said, it's going so well, they're doing very well and all that, but the dance, it has so many dances in it, it's absolutely desperate, you know, we don't know what to do once it dances. And he said, And he said, would you not know of anybody who could help us? She said, yes, I think I could. And they rang me up. And this is how I came along. And I choreographed the Battered Bride for them. I did, and it was a very great success. And this is how it started.
During these first years in Belfast, did you have any nightmares or about what had happened to you?
Yes. Yes, I did. And I woke up screaming. And yes, it did happen. I had nightmares. And I woke up screaming and in a terrible state. But only up to the birth of the children. After that, they stopped. Never again. Giving life defeated death. After the birth of things, I've never had. The first 2 years, quite often, yes.
What sort of nightmares were they?
I can't remember clearly. They were not very, you know, nightmares about the past. About the past. But I can't remember what they were. But I had, yes, quite often.
How did Harry take
Well, Harry
this?
Was very, very understanding and very, very patient and understanding and helpful. He was wonderful, yes, about it, you know, he understood.
And what did you hear of what happened to your mother?
She was taken to Sobibor, which was an extermination camp of the First Order, and disappeared there. Nobody survived there. You know.
How did you manage to deal with these things after the war?
Well, look, if I hadn't managed to deal with it, I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you. It would have destroyed me. I must have learned again. And probably again, giving life, having two lovely, very nice little babies, you know, little boys, helped. Because I knew she would want me. But it wasn't easy.
Do you think that your dance training gave you a tougher constitution?
Physically,
I mean, your legs
yes.
must have been strong.
In some sense, that I knew better than very many others how to use my body. Yes, in certain ways, yes, I think so. It gave me some kind of experience in body management that others didn't have. But I mean, not enough to save me, you know. But still, yes, it helped for some time.
Can you talk a little about the contribution to the artistic and cultural life at Belfast that you've actually been able to make there? What have you...
Well, I was very, very lucky. It was a case of being in the right time, at the right place, at the right time. In Belfast, there had been dance before in the form of classical ballet, but just in schools and visiting companies, not in, and of course Irish dancing. But they didn't have any experience at all of what was called modern or contemporary dance, Laban things. And so it was totally new to them, and the time was ripe. After the Bartered Bride, which was a very great success, you know, papers wrote about it, and they said, weren't they lucky to have an authentic choreographer, Jacob Brand, he said. People rang me up and asked, if you weren't, wouldn't you like to teach a bit, to try it? I said, well, wouldn't do any harm. Once a week, 1 hour a week won't do me any harm. I started with 1 hour a week, and within 6 months I worked full time. Theatre heard about, the Lyric Theatre heard about it. They asked me, would I choreograph for them? My first play was something called Macbeth. The witches needed movement. From then on, I worked there permanently. Musicians became interested. Opera, Northern Ireland Opera, started asking me to contribute to things. Even some music societies. And eventually out of the best, most talented and most dedicated of my pupils, I formed a little group which was called Belfast Modern Dance Group. And that was a performing group which was worked on a much higher level than the others. And I choreographed for them and we did lots of things.
So how well known did you become in artistic circles in Belfast?
Don't, it's a bit embarrassing. Very well known. Still am, yes. There are constantly, I'm meeting constantly people in the street whom I vaguely recognize the face, and it turns out they were former pupils of mine, either in the drama school or in the theatre or in my own private life. I taught in schools, I taught at the College of Higher Education. It was an incredibly busy and fulfilling time, and it went on until 3 years ago when my health gave up. And the last thing I did, maybe this is symbolic too, was the dance drama, the dance of Anne Frank. You know, and you know, where I choreographed that, apart from Belfast, with my own little group, in Germany, in Duisburg, in Germany. A choreographer had seen it. There was a very big evening. I find this a bit embarrassing, you know, sort of celebrating me in the city hall in Belfast. The city council gave an evening in my honor for my contribution to the arts. And the Anne Frank was performed there, and people knew about it. And there was a very avant-garde, in every sense of the word, dance group in Duisburg, in Germany. And they asked me, would I do it for them for the 50th anniversary in 1995 of the liberation. And I went to Germany and choreographed it for the German company. It was very, very nice. And then I got a doctorate from two universities in Belfast and in Coleraine. So I can't complain. Belfast has, and not only Belfast, because I worked also in Dublin and in Cork and other places, but they have been very generous to me, very good. And I have, yes.
Can I ask you about your two sons? What are their names again? Hmm? Your two sons, what are they called? Can you tell me their names again?
Michael and Robin.
What does Michael do for a living?
You don't know. Michael is head of a very big and successful comprehensive school here in Sheffield. School of 1,650 pupils, just imagine. And he's the head,
and,
principal.
Is he married, Michael?
Have you not met Tetra? Yes, and we had two lovely boys, Danny and Robin. Danny and Ben, sorry.
And what is your daughter-in-law's background? Where is she from, Petra?
She's German. She's from Germany. She studied English in Germany, and if you study a foreign language, you have to spend a year in that country. So she came to England to teach for a year German in an English school. That's how she met him. He was at the same school.
Is your daughter-in-law Jewish?
She's German.
German.
She comes from a German family. Yes. And but there was no problem ever. Never, never, never at all. So thanks to God, it was a very good marriage. And
have you asked any questions at all about her family? And
well, Harry and I met her parents. Yes, her father was in the war. He was a prisoner of war in somewhere in Russia. He was in the army. Yes. Met her family, yes, of course. But there has never been any trouble. There were no Nazis, actually. Her only brother has become a very, very devoted, dedicated Jehovah's Witness, which is obvious. You know.
What about your other son?
Robin is a lawyer. But by the way, I have to boast. Michael, after school, studied at Oxford. Robin, after school, same school, studied in Cambridge. And Robin is a lawyer and has now been appointed recently a sort of part-time judge. He's doing very well. And his wife, I'll show you a picture, she's Chinese. And she was one of my dancers. She's a doctor. She came to study medicine in Belfast. And this is how she became my pupil and part of my group. And we became very friendly. And he met her in our house.
And of Harry, what was Harry's job, actually? In
Belfast, Harry never made a very great career in Belfast. Harry had studied in Wien at the university, and he was very, very good in sort of in language. His language was the only language that Harry never properly knew was Czech. But his German, French, English, and Italian, he studied in Vienna and in Italy, in Florence. Harry got a doctorate in Florence.
How long were you together, you and Harry?
Well, we married in 1947, and Harry died in 1991.
Right. Well, just hold it there and change the tape.
You have got the photographs, haven't you?
This is Helen Lewis, tape 10. You were telling me that Harry died in 1991. How often now, with your life in Belfast, does your mind go back to those terrible years during the war in the camps? Do you think about it much?
No, not all. No. No, I think I have a quite healthy instinct not to dwell on it. I can't help sometimes, more often than other times, to go back, but I'm not dwelling on it in self-pity or resentment. This would be very unhealthy. I'm very grateful for what has happened to me, but I cannot. I also reject when people say to me, oh, you must have been so brave and so clever, you know, to have survived. I always say, if you say to somebody who has survived, you survive because you are brave or clever or courageous or whatever, does it mean that those who did not survive didn't have these qualities? That would be a great insult to the death. Survival is something to be grateful for, but not to be proud of.
Have you read many books about the Holocaust, and have you seen films about the Holocaust at all?
I have read some. I'm not saying that I've read. I have read books on the Holocaust, and I have seen some films, but I can't. If you remind me which ones you mean, I will tell you whether I've seen them or not. Yes, I've, but not in great, great quantities.
Are you invited to speak much about your experiences?
Well, since my book came out, I have been invited to speak innumerable times in any kind of college, conference, society, whatever you want to. Very, very many times, yes.
Are there any occasions when you've given these addresses and spoken that have been particularly significant for you?
Well, I can say that most of almost all of the groups that invite me are significant in any way, and particularly in Northern Ireland, where there is a conflict of its own, and where they try to learn from my experience. And what I always tell them is that my experiences have taught me to resist divisions among people of any kind, any time, but of course to admire diversity in people, but not divisions. And I think they take a certain lesson from that.
Before you wrote your book, how much of your experiences had you told Michael and Robin? How much did they know?
Well, Michael and Robin, of course, knew, and they also were interested, and they wanted to know, and I told them. But it was the two of them, who urged me and eventually convinced me to write the book. It was never written for publication. I never thought of it. It was written for them and their and future generations, as I mind. They were at the bottom of it, yes.
And what about your grandchildren? I mean, how old are they again?
Well, they're still very young, you know, and I think it might be a bit too soon for them to learn the lessons and to make it. I would never, never push them into reading it. I think Danny has already read some of it, but I'm not talking to him about it until he will start. I don't want to put any burden on their little psyche.
Now, what about your life now? How do you spend your life now?
Well, my life in the last 3 years has been very different from before, because my health has not been good enough for me anymore to continue in my dance training, but I'm my dance activities. But I'm still interested, and I'm still being asked for advice and for comments and things like that. I'm still in touch with very, very many of my former pupils. And I must also say that some of my former pupils who started with me and have become professionals are very, very successful. And I tell you one particular story which might interest you in that whole context. One of the very rare young fellows, boys, who came to my classes when he was 15 and continued and eventually went into professional training and has lived now for the last few years in America, where he has been teaching at a university, choreographing, performing, anything you like, and has been doing very, very well. But whenever he comes to Belfast, his family still live here. He comes to see me and we talk about things. And the last time he came was last Christmas, and he asked me about episodes from my book, in particular this story, how dance saved my life, and would I tell him about it again. And I did, quite unselfconsciously, and it took me quite a long time before I realized that a little instrument was sitting on the table and that he was actually recording what I was saying. Afterward, we laughed about it. I didn't take it seriously. He has choreographed a dance drama to my tale, to the accompaniment of my voice and music, of course, a whole dance drama, which has been very successful, has been performed quite a number of times, and has made around.
Does your life today have any kind of religious or Judaic dimension?
Look, my life has always had a kind of spiritual dimension, but not religious in the sense of any particular belief or faith or ritual or tradition. I'm quite sure that God has saved me, preserved me, but not a particular God who belongs to a particular group of people. I can't accept it, that it is a different kind of God who belongs to the Jews or to the Catholics or the Protestants or the Muslims or the Hindus or anybody. I cannot accept that there is one God.
Do you think that the world has learned very much, if anything, from the Holocaust and from the experience that your generation went through?
I feel if I look into the paper and look at events nowadays, every day, I fear not enough, no. It may be for a time, but they have pushed it into the past and into forgetfulness again. Terrible, terrible things happening in the world. Nothing perhaps quite as systematically as the Holocaust. People in Northern Ireland have sometimes even tried to compare acts of terrorism and suicide. I would say no, because the most final and deadly phase of the Holocaust was decided by well-educated gentlemen around the table in Wannsee when they decided on the systematic extermination of millions of human beings with a stroke of a pen.
Today, does any part of you feel German or Czech, or do you feel more Irish?
No, I can't feel Irish. Just listen to me and to my accent. That, if nothing else, gives me away. I feel very much at home in Northern Ireland, in Belfast. I feel at home, but I'm not Irish, no. But neither, of course, am I German, by no means. And after all these years, I can't say. I'm still very closely in my feelings and in my connected with my Czech homeland. But I prefer not to be anything.
Do you, as we sort of come to an end now, Mrs. Lewis, do you have a message for the younger generations you'd like to, any message you'd like to give at the end of this testimony?
To appreciate all human beings as equal and not to make any divisions on racial or religious or social grounds. All people, if they had the same opportunities, would be much more equal than they are now. And we all must strive to achieve a good standard for everybody, no matter how far away they live or how close.
Thank you very much indeed for giving your testimony.
Is this okay?
Could I,
what I said just in the end now, is this all right?
Yes, it's beautiful. Thank you very much.
Is there
anything else you'd like to say?
Don't laugh. No, why should I? I'm sure I have left out masses of episodes, but we would sit until midnight if I did.
Thank you very much.
Well, you are not going to use all that. My grandparents, Samuel and Josephine Katz. I think the photograph was taken in Trutnov in the early days of their marriage. My grandparents on mother's side, station master Julius Glück and his wife Jenny, with their children Else, my mother, and Heinrich, her younger brother.
And when do you think that photograph was taken?
Well, I would expect that she may have been perhaps about 10 or 12 years at the time. She was born in 1893. So, and I would think perhaps 1902 or 1903, something like that.
And where was it taken, do you think?
Probably in the place where my grandfather worked at the time, in Posice near Trutnov. It's a very important railway station. My father, Hugo Katz, roughly in his mid-20s, I'm sure it was taken in Trutnov, his hometown. My mother, Else Katz, née Glück, when she was roughly in her middle-20s, I would imagine, also probably taken in Trutnov. That is myself in my very early dancing days at the age of 6.
Taken in?
Trutnov, yes. This is myself, Helen Lewis, in the background, taking part in a performance of my dance academy, Milcha Majerova in Prague.
When roughly was it taken?
I think 1937.
Can we do a detail on that?
The occasion was the wedding of my uncle Erwin Katz in Prague in 1941, when Jews had already to wear the yellow star. And as you can see, the whole group is wearing the yellow star. On the very right is my mother, beside her my first husband Paul, and beside her myself, and then my uncle Erwin.
And who are the others? Do you know?
His wife and the others are, I think, her family. And I don't know.
And what happened to those people? Do you know?
He was in that September transport that went to Auschwitz and was completely gassed in 6 months later. He and she were in that transport.
And where was that wedding group taken?
I'm not quite sure. It must have been taken outside some building in Prague where the wedding ceremony took place. It doesn't look like a very official building to me in the street of Prague. This is a message that my late husband, Paul Hermann, managed to smuggle out from his concentration camp Schwarzheide near Oranienburg, sometimes early in 1945, in which he asked the friends to whom he sent it to send him something to eat, some food parcels, and mentions also that he doesn't know what the fate is of his mother or of his wife, myself. This is a document that people who returned from the camps after the war were given out in Prague by a central office for repatriation of prisoners who were imprisoned for political and racist reasons. This is my dearest friend, Alice Berger Hammerschlag, who was born in Vienna and came to Belfast by marriage, where she used her exceptional talent in very wonderful expressions of painting and drawings. She also was my dearest and most valuable friend ever. She died, unfortunately, in 1969. This is one of her valuable paintings called Calvary, Old and New, which unfortunately is at the moment buried in the cellar of the Ulster Museum. Also, it would be of very, very great value if it was shown every day of the year to the public. This is a photograph of my first husband, Paul Herman, who was born in 1908, somewhere in Yugoslavia, and lived then in Czechoslovakia, and we got married in Prague in 1938. He unfortunately didn't survive the war and died somewhere in Schwarzheide in the early 19 years of months of 1945.
When was that taken, do you think?
I think he must, it was taken perhaps around the time of our marriage in 1938 or maybe 1937 or 1939. He was quite young then.
In Czechoslovakia?
Oh yes, I'm sure. A wedding picture of myself, Helen Lewis, and my husband Harry, taken in Prague in 1947 after our wedding at the City Hall in Prague. This is myself, Helen Lewis, enjoying myself through movement in the garden of our house in Belfast. The picture was taken roughly in the early 1950s. This is my husband Harry somewhere on a holiday, enjoying themselves in the sun. It must have been sometimes in the early 70s.
Where was it taken? Do you know?
I don't know. I have no idea. This is a graduation of myself, Helen Lewis, when I was given an honorary doctorate at the University of Ulster in Coleraine. On the picture left from right is my son, elder son Michael, and on the other side of myself, my younger son Robin. The time was 1993. This is my younger son, Robin, and his wife, Sarah. The photograph was taken quite recently, I think, in 1998, early 1998, in their house in Hertfordshire, in Nebworth in Hertfordshire. This is a photograph taken of my most recent dance drama called The Dance of Anne Frank, which was taken in Belfast after a performance at the City Hall in Belfast.
When was it taken now?
In 1995. This is a cover of my book, A Time to Speak, which is a biography and tale of my very colorful life. It came out in 1992 and has been reprinted several times, among other places, also in Italy and in America.
And that just the middle.
This is a copy of a message given to me by a generous Russian officer at the end of the war, which is reproduced in my book as a document of my survival.
Do you know what it says on there?
It says on it that he was a major in the Soviet Army, and he asks any Russian comrade whom I may meet to help me towards a safe return home to my homeland. This is my little grandson, Daniel, aged 12 by now, who is a great sportsman, a very fine young cellist, and a delightful young boy altogether.
You know, Do you want me to ask you who the other people are? Oh, there's a president of Ireland, of course.
Yes, I can't tell. This is my graduation from Queen's University, Belfast, in Northern Ireland, in 1996. On the picture, celebrating that great occasion, are on my left the Vice Chancellor of the University, and on my right behind me, the lady who was a Vice Chancellor then and is now President Mary McAleese of the Irish Republic.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Helen, for this testimony.
I don't know whether she was a Vice Chancellor or a pro Vice Chancellor, but maybe that doesn't matter. No. No, she wasn't a Vice-Chancellor then. No, he was a Vice-Chancellor. She was, at best, a pro-Vice-Chancellor. Can we repeat that? Can we? Would you?
Just say it again.
Yes. Yeah. This is a picture of my graduation from Queen's University, Belfast, in 1996. On my left on that occasion is the Vice Chancellor of Queen's University, and behind me on the right is the pro Vice Chancellor of Queen's University, who is nowadays the President of the Irish Republic, Dr. Mary McAleese.
Thank you very much. That completes the photographic session. Helen, would you like to introduce your family?
I certainly will be very glad to do that. Here on my right sits my elder son, Michael. Beside him, his wife, Petra. Beside her, their elder son, Daniel. And beside me on my left, Ben, my youngest grandson.
Now, because you live in Ireland, are you able to see your family frequently or not so frequently?
Not enough. I see them, but not enough for my own liking. But I'm very grateful every time I do.
How old were your two boys when you began to tell them about your experiences?
I'm not quite sure what age they were, but when I began to tell them. But I remember from quite an early age on, they started asking questions because they knew somehow that their background and their origin was different from their friends. And they started asking questions, and I had to be careful and slow in answering them.
Do you think that your experiences in the Holocaust in any way affected how you brought the boys up, affected you as a parent?
I hope not. I wouldn't like to think so. It may have done so subconsciously, but not in any deliberate way.
Michael, how interested were you as a growing boy in your mother's story?
I think I probably started asking first questions somewhere around the age of Ben and Daniel, somewhere between the age of 10 and 12. And as Mum says, bit by bit, the story unraveled. And obviously the very first things I asked were very naive, and had to do with the fact that we didn't seem to have cousins and aunts and uncles like lots of other children. One of the most significant things was actually going to Czechoslovakia when I was about 15, 15 and a half, and going and actually visiting the town where my parents had come from, and also staying with a family that Mum had got to know in Terezin, and who had had similar experiences, and who had a son of my age with whom I'm still in contact. So really it happened quite slowly. And I mean, living in Northern Ireland, which was a very conformist sort of society, most children just want to fit in. And really going to Czechoslovakia for the first time was quite an important turning point, from feeling quite awkward about the fact that my parents were different and had problems. They didn't know how to play cricket, for example, and stood out as being different and had a strange accent. And that was problematic, to actually beginning to have pride and then growing pride in them and understanding their experiences a bit more.
Was the
questioning of your mother, did it produce the answers easily, or was there a sort of a restraint?
I really can't remember. I mean, it didn't come out as a flood or a cascade. I think it was more a story that revealed itself bit by bit, and whether that was a reticence on my part in terms of what I was asking and what I knew and didn't know, or whether it was something that you managed very carefully, I don't know. But it coincided with, I mean, I recall the Eichmann trial, because we got the Jewish Chronicle each week. I recall the Frankfurt trials in the early 60s. So there were many things that began to happen. There was also an outbreak of anti-Semitism in Europe, which I was aware of as a 12-year-old, I think, must have been at the time. So there were various things that contributed to a growing awareness.
Do you recall what feelings your mother's story gave you and produced in you as her story unfolded?
No, not really, to be honest. I don't. I think that took a long time to sort out. And I mean, I think I'm still, you know, digesting some of that. I don't recall really. I mean, I know that that when I learned for the first time that Mum had been married previously, I know that the first question I asked was whether there were any other children. But no, I don't actually recall. I don't recall feeling distressed. I don't recall feeling angry. But I suspect I probably felt both those things on occasions.
And then when you found Petra, who is of German nationality, ironically, did that cause any tensions at all between you and your mother when you announced that you're going to marry Petra?
No, not at all. I mean, I think if I had known that it was going to, then I suspect that would have, in a sense, dealt with the event. But I had gone to work in Germany. I had made a series of decisions. I mean, I had chosen to study German. Our house at home in Belfast is full of the sort of cultural background that I'm sure Mum has described earlier. I mean, books and books and books, many of them in German. And of course, as a student, I was able to read those. So, I mean, I had a view and an understanding through personal experience and through my studies of what being German means. It never caused any problem, and I don't think it ever caused a problem either for your family.
Can I ask you, Petra, how did you introduce your parents, who of course were young adults in the time of the Nazi regime, how did you introduce your parents to the idea that you were marrying the son of a Holocaust survivor?
I think I just told them. You know, who Michael's family were, and I think they just accepted it. There never was, well, when my parents and Helly and Harry met, they never talked about the past. They got on extremely well always, and I think it never, certainly to me, my parents never talked about it, you know, that it presented any problems or worries. It probably did, but there was no, you know, there was never any comment from them that would have tried to put me off or make me think about it or, you know, anything like that at all.
There was always a great deal of warmth.
Yes.
Right from the start.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think relations with one's parents-in-law, with one's in-laws, are complicated enough potentially in any case, and I mean, we've quite often talked about that ourselves, no, that was not problematic, and neither has it been problematic between us.
Mm-hmm. Please change on to change.
This is tape 11. We were discussing the relationship when you first met.
Yes.
Can I ask, has the Holocaust in your family home in Germany ever been a subject at all for general discussion in any way?
Not while I grew up. I think I never heard about it from my parents. I heard about it in school. And I think at the time it caused a great deal of anger in me, particularly with my father, I think.
Why particularly with your father? Was he very active in the...
Because he was a soldier. And he fought in the war, and he also was of the generation that had gone through the whole indoctrination of the Nazi regime. He was just the right age for, you know, to go through all the institutions and so on. And he'd been a prisoner of war in Russia after the war for 5 years. And he was very anti-communist, very anti-Russia, and held a lot of views, I think, that I as a teenager found very difficult, and there were arguments about that.
What sort of views, can I ask you?
Well, I think he felt that when I was a teenager in Germany, there was a lot of history. I think Germany tried to come to terms with the Nazi time and the Holocaust. There was a lot about it on television, and he was very, very opposed to that. He kept saying, you know, they shouldn't rake over this, and he just, I think, wanted to forget it, really. And, you know, I think for him, everything that came from Russia and, you know, had to do with communism, you couldn't talk to him about it. You immediately sort of had a wall of antagonism. And therefore, I think discussions were very difficult. And I was a teenager, and I couldn't really understand that my parents' generation kept telling me they didn't know about any of the things that had gone on. So that caused the friction, I think.
And do they still say that now?
Well, I was talking to Ellie about it yesterday, because I feel my father's dead. My father died in 1988. I feel now that I'm older and perhaps a bit wiser. I would like to talk to him about it, and we would perhaps get further. my mother has still, I think, says that she didn't know a lot about it, but she has become very interested in any programs on television in Germany that deal with the time. She's been telling me repeatedly recently that she has seen programs that you know, about topics to do with the Nazi time that she never knew anything about, and I think she's become quite interested in that.
How soon would you like Daniel and Benjamin, your sons, to know that the story in perhaps greater detail than they do at the moment?
That's a difficult question, because we haven't sorted that out between us, because I'm a bit worried that because of my German background that they would feel, you know, anti the family and anti the grandmother, and I'm sure that wouldn't happen, but I'm very worried about getting the balance right and getting it them at the right time, and so far I've felt that they're too young for it, really. And also, it hasn't come up yet in school, so that they would come with questions. You know, they've not discussed that period.
Although both Benjamin and Daniel do ask questions,
yeah.
And whenever they do, we'll give them answers.
Mm-hmm.
As a headmaster of a very large school here in Sheffield, Do you have on your syllabus and curriculum anything at all to do with that part of the war?
Well, yes, we do. It's part of the history syllabus, but issues to do with racism and to do with values and ethics are core parts of our personal and social education program as well. So every student in the school encounters issues. As far as the history syllabus is concerned, for example, we obviously teach about Nazism, about fascism, about the Third Reich, about the Holocaust. We use local resources within the city in terms of survivors, people who came on the Kindertransport, people who have got direct connections. And we devote a whole day of intensive work. We actually use the Quaker Centre in the centre of Sheffield and make it into, if you like, a quasi-residential intensive piece of work. We also work together with our partners in Germany, in the Goethe-Schule, which is a similar school to ours in Bochum, in the Ruhr, very close to where Petra comes from. And each year we take a group of 30 or 40 students to Germany, and they study issues of contemporary German, or 20th century German and European history. They've been, for example, to the synagogue in Essen. They have met with survivors there. They have just political discussions as well. So, yes, we do all those sorts of things.
So, inevitably, then, your sons will be exposed to that sort of material at school, won't they?
Yes, but I think that those issues would have emerged many times by the time they get to that stage. Yes. I think both Daniel and Ben are quite alert and in their own way well informed, and the time will come when they want to talk about these things. Daniel's read A Time to Speak, but I think probably took in just the basic lines of the story. Ben says he'd like to read it. They're both a little bit young, although the language is simple, the story is complex. But I would anticipate that we will be talking about these sorts of things fairly regularly for years to come.
How important do you think the events of today have been, and that we've recorded your mother's testimony in this way?
Well, I think it's very important. It's difficult for us, for Petra and myself, to imagine what we might be saying to Daniel's children and Benjamin's children in 20, 25 years' time, when the events will be almost 100 years old, and in the world in which we live, that is just an age, a huge gap. So I think that to understand and to be able to draw lessons of all sorts, the immediacy of visual testimony in a visual age, and the direct communication that comes from this sort of exercise, I think is very important. And I also think for other people, outside our immediate family, the recording of experience, testimony, is important too.
Do you think your mother is a remarkable woman?
Yes and no. It's a silly answer to give. The experience of a son is that one just has one's mother and takes that person for granted in many ways, and sees the normality of that person day after day, for years. And one never thinks in those terms of, my mother or anybody else is remarkable. On the other hand, everything I know about her, makes her very remarkable, yes.
How often do you think about those terrible years that overwhelmed your mother? Is it something you think about very much?
I'd say most weeks, if not virtually most days, in one form or other, yeah.
And do you feel sort of directly touched by her experiences?
I feel influenced by them enormously, yes.
In what particular way?
Well, I think I swallow completely the
the value system that my mother will have talked to you about, and I think it influences the world that I want my own children to grow up into, and the shared values that we have as a family, and it influences my work, and it continues to cause me to reflect over and again on deeper matters of human experience, and it influences my reading, and I suppose I'm just beginning to discover an urge to be more in touch with the roots that I've never really known. Maybe that comes with creeping up towards 50, another significant and dangerous ages.
Final word from you, Helen. Just a final, would you like something you'd like to say, finally, with your family around you now?
I think both Harry and I have been very, very lucky in our family relationship with our children, and it was always totally unforced and came about quite naturally. And all the difficult questions that were caused by the events in my life seemed to be solved in a loving, natural way without any undue constraint or inhibitions. Both my sons, you know, Michael and Robin, have always responded very positively, but in the right sense positively, to anything that has been mentioned about our past, and we have never had any unusual or relationship with each other that other families have not. We have continued to be a close, loving family, and that has extended eventually after they grew up and became married to the daughters-in-law. Thankfully.
Thank you all very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, that's a wrap.
Okay.